Hey everybody, Antoni here in Bordeaux, where I saw Offenbach's Le Comte of Man, which was at the Opera Nationale de Bordeaux. The conductor was Marc Minkowski. The production was done by Vincent Huguet. The sets were done by Aurélien Maestre. The costumes were done by Clément Spernoud. The lights were handled by Bertrand Couderc. The dramaturgy was handled by Louis Geisler. And the chorus master was Salvatore Caputo. I was really excited to check out this particular production of Le Comte of Man at the Opéra National de Bordeaux because this was the first time I saw and heard Jessica Pratt live as all four heroines. On top of that, there was a wonderful British tenor whose name was completely new to me, but I'm so thankful to have seen him last night. And he was Adam Smith, who performed the titular hero. Now, before we get to the singers, I would love to talk about the production. Overall, I found it to be quite interesting in terms of how everything played out. Obviously, the action was transported from the 18th century all the way up to, I would say, the 19th to early 20th century. And it doesn't open with the overture. Oh no. It instead opens with a segment of Finca dal Vino from Mozart's Don Giovanni, sung by Eberhard Vechta. And after the overture, we don't see a chorus of spirits embodying wine or beer, but we see people waiting outside the theater for Stella until the muse, who is in a sort of androgynous getup, comes in and gathers some clothes so that she could disguise herself as Niklaus. And what's quite interesting about this particular production is the presence of the Greek-style buildings that occur. Not only do we get that from the first act, or the prologue, but also the acts consisting of Olympia, Antonia, and Giulietta, and even that of the epilogue, probably to show that this is the theater that has a lot of historical meaning. And speaking of Olympia's act, she is not the robotic doll that traditional audiences are accustomed to seeing her as. Instead, she is a sort of beauty pageant contestant designed by Spallanzani in order to be up against two other competitors named Norma and Violetta, who are named after the heroines of Bellini's opera and Verdi's opera, Norma and Traviata, respectively. And I thought it was rather interesting to see Olympia not as an emotionless doll whose eyes are so wide they stare right into your soul, but a sort of prima donna who is quite sweet on the outside to everyone else and has to smile and wave when she sees her audience, but is kind of a brat when all the curtains are closed. Probably as a precursor to the likes of Baby Jane Hudson from Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, or even that of Darla Dimple from Cats Don't Dance, which I thought was rather fun as it did manage to give a lot more dimension to Olympia. And she doesn't end up submitting to Hoffman as a sort of doll, but she ends up rejecting him, which adds a little bit more fieriness in terms of her temperament and in terms of what she is as a starlet. So a lot of these acts are meant to also show the different sides of who Stella is as a woman. We see the Olympia side, in which she is quite youthful, yet sweet on the outside, but kind of a spoiled brat on the inside. Antonia, who is very passionate about her craft and really loving and very human, to the point where she will give up everything for the sake of her art, and even if she has to die for it, she will still keep on going. And Giulietta, who is a sensual yet manipulative woman who kind of leads men on. So I definitely enjoy this approach when it came to how all of Hoffman's women are incorporated into one woman, which is Stella. And the costumes were quite wonderful. When we first see Hoffman, he comes in his sleeveless undershirt and black pants to show that, yes, he was really busy working on something like a new piece of work, but he was interrupted by Niklaus and he ends up being dragged along to see the other spectators and other fans of Stella before he launches onto his Kleinsach song. And even as he's suited up, he then starts to tell his tale of his three lovers. And during those tales, we see Hoffmann not only in a suit, but also white shoes, which I thought were kind of out of place when it comes to his overall attire. I would have loved to see him in black shoes so they don't end up color clashing each other. And speaking of the colors, what I notice about the colors of Hoffmann's loves is that they all wear a shade of red. With Olympia's case, she not only has red, but also has a fuchsia brooch and some fuchsia around her to show that she is rather girlish and coquettish and not too doll-like and has a semblance of innocence. Whereas with Antonia, she appears in bright red to show that she is passionate. She is madly in love with Hoffmann and will give everything to be with him forever. And she's also very passionate about her craft. Accompanying that is her black robe to show that she does have a deadly condition and she will end up succumbing to it at the end of her tale. Whereas with Giulietta, she is in crimson to show that she is a sensual and passionate woman who can lead men on using her manipulation powers. Stella also has bright red to show that, yes, she is a woman of passion and beauty, but can sometimes be a woman full of temperament and someone who you do not want to piss off so badly. Moreover, this is the version I saw with Niklaus singing the Une poupée des yeux de mail, and even Dappertutto's original diamond aria, and Giulietta's coloratura aria, L'amour lui dit la belle. And there were also no cuts whatsoever. And speaking of which, the ending was just as touching, with the muse being revealed as her true self, and Stella being stripped away of her pomp, Landorf being stripped away of his nastiness, and André being stripped away of his overly comical presence to comfort Hoffmann as they all sing in this wonderful ensemble. So I thought it managed to wrap up everything well, and it also helped that the backdrop also lifted to show that, to quote Shakespeare, all the world's a stage, and all the men and women are merely players, which is something that Hoffmann has been ingraining not only at the start of the opera, but also at the end of it. So overall, I definitely enjoyed this production of Le Comte Hoffmann. It was surprisingly fresh, but at the same time, it managed to leave me with a lot of great moments to root for. Especially that one moment where Dr. Miracle ends up disguising Niklaus as Antonia's mother as part of his devilish scheme to end up killing her by using her, who is basically the muse in disguise, to kill Antonia with her singing. And once Niklaus, aka the muse, ends up finishing her deed, she is absolutely aghast at what she has done. So that was definitely another level of interest, and also to show the tension that is occurring between Niklaus, or the muse in disguise, and Hoffmann's many loves. So I thought it was just really interesting, really fun, and it left me on the edge of my seat every single time. And now we get to the singers, starting off with Adam Smith as Hoffmann. Now, I never heard about him before, and when I read that he was going to replace Eric Cutler in the remaining performances as Hoffmann, I was quite skeptical at first because I was not so sure how his voice would hold up in the theater, nor did I have any idea who this tenor was. But as I heard and saw him last night, I can definitely say with pride that he is my new favorite tenor. What I noticed about his voice is that it has Roberto Alagna's Gallic and metallic charm and focus, Neil Shikoff's power and incision, and Jose Carreras's lyricism. Three of my favorite tenors combined into one fabulous young tenor whose career is going from strength to strength, and it shows no signs of stopping. What I definitely enjoyed about Adam Smith's portrayal as Hoffmann was how much life he was able to bring into this particular character. He brought in so much exuberance, not only in his movements, which should come off as no surprise considering how athletic he was on stage and how his build is lean yet muscular and athletic, which is something that I found really charming about him. And there was something about him that made me root for him. It's not only found in the way he was able to move around the stage and embody Hoffmann with this youthfulness and charm and everything about him that made him stand out as a performer, but also in his voice. He showed no signs of tiredness, no signs of fatigue, and he had an excellent instrument which he was able to make great use of. If there was one flaw I had with his overall singing, was there were times that he ducked some of the high notes, which was kind of a shame because Adam Smith's instrument is absolutely brilliant. This is the type of tenor singing we need today more than ever. He is someone who is a shining example of what it's like to also sing all of these wonderful roles with such aplomb, and he does it masterfully. And the passion, the exuberance, and the charm all reflect in his voice and in his mannerisms. So bravo to Mr. Adam Smith for a job well done, as this is a tenor I need to look out for more often because of his ever-growing career, and of course, how he was able to prove to himself that he was a fine and absolutely phenomenal singing actor. Od Extremo was phenomenal as Niklaus the Muse and even the ghost of Antonia's mother. When I first heard about her, I was kind of skeptical about her. She did have a very promising and huge repertoire, ranging from roles like Amneris from Aida to even the likes of Anna from Le Toyon, as well as the likes of Carmen and Venus from Tannhäuser. But as I heard her voice live, I was completely floored. This is the type of singing from any mezzo that we need today. We really need to hear mezzos who are unafraid to go into their chest voice and really milk it for everything they've got. This is a mezzo who is able to sound so seductively and so alluringly that I was able to keep my eyes glued to her every single step of the way. She was definitely the one who stole the show because of her magnificent prowess as a singing actress. And I really hope that she continues to develop her chest tones. I hope that she continues to make a great use of the instrument of hers, because she has so much potential to rise above and make an international career for herself. Sure, when it came to her performance as Antonia's mother, I would have loved to have a contralto singing her, like what we would have had with Bonita Hyman, or even that of Stephanie Blythe. Heck, even Andrea Baker would have made for really fine mothers of Antonia. But regardless of all that, I still have to give Od Extremo loads of credit for everything she was as a singing actress. She was able to make great use of her instrument, and I really hope that she continues to develop as a singing actress. What more can I say about Jessica Pratt when she sang all of the four heroines? There was no doubt that I'd been following her career as mostly a bel canto singer. She has been very well known for the likes of Lucia from Lucia de Lammermoor, a role that she has been performing all around the world, and even in some of her comical ventures into the likes of Rosina, Adina, Norina, and Marie from La Fille du Régiment. Hearing her as all four heroines was definitely a major treat. As Olympia, she was girlish and dainty, and her voice was as clear as a church bell on top of a steeple. That was just how phenomenal she was in terms of embodying Olympia and her occasional cattiness. Her rendition of Les Oiseaux dans la Charmille may have been a bit campy in some areas, but I could totally forgive all that, as she was able to make a great use of her clear, bell-like voice to bring out so much magic and so many acrobatics in Olympia. As Antonia, she was poignant and heartbreaking. She was able to use that creaminess in her voice to make Antonia come alive as a character. And I thought she sold it magnificently in that role, especially in the trio between her, Nicola Cavalier, who I'll talk about later in this review, and Ode Extremo as the mother. As Giulietta, she pleasantly surprised me in that role, because if you know me, as much as I prefer any fine spinto or lyric soprano with great high notes singing Giulietta, I would rather prefer a much more sensual mezzo-soprano, or even that of a dramatic soprano singing Giulietta. Voices that come into my mind when it comes to Giulietta are mainly the likes of Rosé Stevens, Agnes Balza, Waltraud Meyer, Kate Aldrich, and even Béatrice Ullier-Monzon in her prime. With Jessica Pratt as Giulietta, I definitely loved the way she was able to build herself up from the girlish daintiness of Olympia to Antonia's lyrical yet painful moments in her act, and even those longing lines in which she was able to pull off well in that role, to Giulietta's more charged up, fiery, and absolutely riveting passions being all encompassed, especially in her coloratura aria, L'amour lui dit la belle, which I definitely enjoyed. She was able to navigate everything with such aplomb that I had to give her so much praise. And even her acting performance as Stella was wonderful, basically playing her up to be a typical opera diva in the vein of Carlotta from Phantom of the Opera. I thought she was definitely fun when selling it to that part. So what more can I say about Jessica Pratt that hasn't been said already? She is a complete musician. She is an absolutely dedicated singing actress. Her voice shows no signs of wear and tear. She was absolutely versatile in all four heroines, and she managed to take me at the palms of her hands and just make me eat off of that so wonderfully. It's like I'm having a 5-course meal with her, and everything about it is just delicious and well made. So brava to Jessica Pratt for a job phenomenally done, from the clockwork acrobatics of Olympia to Antonia's lyrical yet painful suffering, to Giulietta's sensuality, to Stella's diva moments. I definitely bought her in everything that she embodied. Then we have Nicola Cavalier, who sang the roles of Landorf, Coppelius, Dr. Miracle, and Dappertutto. My word, was he able to embody these roles with virility, a certain serpentine presence, and of course, lots of charisma, which he was able to accomplish with his richly toned and velvety basso cantante voice. As Landorf, he was sly and sneaky as a fox who was able to use his cunning so magnificently. As Coppelius, he was able to be like a sort of hyena or a jackal who was on the verge of becoming really mad and becoming unhinged. As Dr. Miracle, he was like a vulture flying all around the stage in order to capture his prey. And as Dappertutto, he was a venomous viper, so full of poison dripping from his acid tongue that I was completely sold. Everything that he managed to accomplish, as all four villains managed to leave me with so many wonderful moments and leave me with such glee. Equally as phenomenal was Marc Moyon as all four servants. I refuse to believe that this baritone is a baritone, because after hearing his performance last night, as well as listening to some of his performances on YouTube, I'm fully convinced that he is in reality a tenor, a lyric tenor at that, who disguises himself as a baritone because it was probably based on the training that he received that he was going to end up as a baritone, but he was in actuality a tenor. Which I really have to say that after listening to Marc Moyon's performance of All Four Servants, I am completely convinced that Marc Moyon is truly a tenor. He was able to master the tessitura of all four servants so magnificently. I did not hear any type of strain in his voice, and I'm pretty sure that if he retrained his voice, he could be a lyric tenor, a full lyric tenor at that, who can sing all of these graceful lines with everything that he has, instead of being a quote-unquote baritone. Because that's where I feel that his voice should go, the tenor route, and not the baritone route, even though he has a nice voice, even though it is nicely emitted. So I really hope that in the future, Marc Moyon would be able to redevelop his voice into being a tenor. And I do hope that he either considers that or probably thinks about it, because I don't hear a baritone there. I hear a tenor whose voice wants to go in the direction where it's supposed to be. In spite of that gripe, I still have to give Marc Moyon a lot of credit where credit is due. He was absolutely charming in all of these roles, and I have to salute him for everything that he had to offer as all four servants. Jérôme Vanier was a solid Lutel and Crespel. Sure, he did not have the signature darkness, richness, and roundness evidenced in other basso profondos such as Giulio Neri or even that of Gottlob Frick, but I still have to give him credit where credit is due. It does have that plushness. It does have that darkness in his voice that makes him imposing. And speaking of imposing, he is also quite a tower of a man. He was able to use his imposing height to embody these characters so well that I was completely sold. Yet more than anything, it's his performance as Crespel that managed to leave me on the edge of my seat, as opposed to the comic relief of Lutel. He was able to give Crespel a lot of soul and warmth, which I had to give Monsieur Vanier a lot of credit where credit is due. Christophe Mortagne was charismatic and lively as Spallanzani. Sure, I do have a bit of a love-hate relationship with his voice. On the one hand, it has a lot of character. It has those inflections that make him very ideal for comical characters and characters who usually play second fiddle to a lot of the leading characters. On the other hand, it's nasal, it's kind of constricted, and it's not a voice I'm a fan of. That's not to discredit him as a singing actor, not by any means. He does commit himself to everything he's got as Spallanzani. And for that, I have to salute him for taking on this role that he's been performing for many years. Interestingly enough, he's also performed the roles of all four servants, André, Cochenil, Franz, and Pitichinaccio. He was able to pull off Spallanzani rather well, even though I do have a love-hate relationship with his voice. In fact, there have been light tenors who were able to sing this role really well, such as Robert Thier and René Lapelletrie. But regardless of all that, I could still say that Christophe Mortagne was able to give it his all and have a lot of fun with his character. Éric Huchet was rather charming as Nathanael and really surprising as Schlemiel. With Nathanael, he was able to make great use of his character tenor voice to bring this particular student to life, and I could definitely tell that he had a lot of charm and a lot of vivaciousness to work off of. With Schlemiel, even though I do prefer a baritone singing this role, a la Charles Cambon, or what we had back then with the likes of Yuri Yurchuk, among many other baritone Schlemiels, I could still give him credit where credit is due. He embodied this role rather well, even though I am missing that baritone fullness. Regardless of all that, Éric Huchet is a dedicated singing actor, and I salute him for being able to pull these roles off really well. Finally, we have Clément Godard, who is able to sing the roles of Herman and the captain of the police really well. Sure, his roles were really small and they didn't really give him a lot to work off of, but he was still able to use that baritone voice so well that I hear a lot of potential for it to grow and mature. So overall, the singing was absolutely amazing, especially if you have the likes of Adam Smith, who was a virile and charming Hoffman, Jessica Pratt, who was a dainty, girlish, and pretty Cady Olympia, a suffering Antonia, who has a lot of passion and beauty, a sensual Giulietta, who is also quite cold and calculating, and a very fun and diva-like Stella, and even Nicolas Cavalier, who is able to embody Landorf's slyness, Coppelius's madness, Miracle's murderous intent, and Dapertutto's viper-like personality. Oh, unless they forget about Aude Extrémaux, who is able to do a magnificent job as Niklaus, the muse, and the voice of Antonia's mother. Every singer deserves a whole lot of credit for what he or she did, and for that, I really have to give them a lot of kudos for everything they managed to accomplish, because they were all pros. There was not one singer who stood out like a sore thumb. Everyone did a magnificent job, and the conducting done by Marc Minkowski was absolutely phenomenal. He definitely whipped up that orchestra into great shape, and it showed. And let's not forget about the chorus and the orchestra of the Opera Nationale de Bordeaux. They were just as phenomenal as the main singers, and they also deserve a lot of praise, which I am so willing to give to them. So overall, with a very wonderful production of Hoffman, as well as equally phenomenal singers in the forms of Adam Smith, Jessica Pratt, Nicolas Cavalier, Aude Extrémaux, and Marc Moyon, and backed up by fine conducting accomplished by Marc Minkowski, last night's performance of Le Comte Hoffman at the Opéra National de Bordeaux was an absolute wonder. If you haven't seen this opera yet, please go check it out. If mainly for the wonderful production and, of course, an all-star cast. And for those of you who already saw this production of Le Comte Hoffman, what'd you think of it? Do you feel like Adam Smith stood out so well as Hoffman? Did you also feel that Jessica Pratt stole the show as all four heroines? Was there a singer from the main cast you really, really loved? Or did you feel like there was someone that stood out like a sore thumb? Comment below and let me know. Well, that's all for now. This is basically my only opera review here in Bordeaux, mostly because I just want to use the time I have here in Bordeaux to just go around some sites and just walk to the really wonderful monuments that it has to offer. But don't worry, my reviewing schedule will come back up into speed when I get to Dresden, especially when I have three wonderful operas to review. So until then, have a great day, everybody.